describe the input of radiology in the imaging and evaluation of urosepsis. As mentioned earlier, the urosepsis is of different grades. It can be very mild and asymptomatic, and then it can increase in severity up to systemic inflammatory response syndrome with fever, hypothyroidism, and hyperleukocytosis, and can go into circulatory and organ failure. I begin with this study. It is a German study which evaluates retrospectively patients with systemic inflammatory response syndrome. And interestingly, that they found that CT confirmed the suspected diagnosis in 26%. And then the extension of infection, this is an example of flaring of chronic infection by XGP. And here we can see that the perimetric spaces are involved, and even the posterior parietal layer is thickened and enhancing, so this is most likely stage 3. Extension of infection also can go by fistula stress into the anterior abdominal wall and form a muscular abscess. So this is very serious, and in this example we have central lithiasis, we have chronically infected kidneys surrounded by fat stranding, and this is fistula stress forming a large intermuscular abscess. Cyst infection, cyst is very common finding, but don't forget that some complicated cysts, like type 2, could be a source or beginning of sepsis, and in CT it will appear as enhanced wall. Pyonephrosis is nothing less than a hydronephrosis which become infected, but here how we can confidently diagnose pyonephrosis, again, by fatty stranding, enhancement of wall. This is mean that the tissue is friable, is very vascular, and this is denoting pyonephrosis or infection on top of pyonephrosis. Lower urinary tract infection, we will go fast. Again, the notion of CT spaces is very important, as we said about the perinephric and pararenal space. Again, in the pelvis, we must note that the anterior space to the urinary bladder is the lytic space, and it is continuous with the anterior abdominal wall. So infection in the anterior aspect of the urinary bladder can extend into the anterior abdominal wall. Posteriorly, pararectal and perisacral space can get also involved. In the male anatomy, the superficial and deep perineal spaces are also very important sites of abscess formation or pus collection. So I will begin by seminal vesicle, but because I feel that the infection of this organ is so much underestimated in our daily practice, acute seminal vesicolitis can be secondary to acute prostatitis, can be due to instrumentation or in immunocompromised patient. Here in ultrasound, we depend on the increase of the size of the seminal vesicles in addition to other constitutional sign. Prostatic infection, prostatitis, and abscess formation. We must note here that below the prostate gland there is a deep perineal space. So prostatitis and prostatic abscess will appear as abscess everywhere. Fluid filled structure of fluid filled cavity, increase in size of prostate gland. Again, periprostatic fatty stranding, and possibly extension of infection into the deep perineal space. Epididymal orchitis, of course we know it, and it can develop into scrotal abscess. Scrotal abscess can be intratesticular, can be extratesticular, and can be in subcutaneous tissue. So in any case of epididymal orchitis, we should spend a lot of time looking for any collection or abscess formation, whether within the testicle, or in the tunica vaginalis, or in the subcutaneous tissue. Fournier gangrene is a life-threatening condition. It is a polymicrobial necrotizing fasciitis that involves the perineal, perianal, and genital organs. This is common in diabetic patients. Diagnosing this category can be life-saving for the patient. The beginning of the ultrasound, you can feel that the scrotal subcutaneous tissue is so much thickened, and sometimes you cannot even see the testis because of presence of gas shadowing. So here you should suspect presence of gas. You can go to CT, and here CT can disclose the presence of gas within the scrotum and the perineal space. Fornia gangrene is a very serious condition. Perineal infection can arise from other sites than the urinary tract, like perineal infection. I will take only 1 second about the genitourinary tuberculosis, because also this is underdiagnosed in our community. This list, I will not go through it, the list about 18 radiological findings, but you can collect them into five criteria. The presence of chronic symptoms and signs, and the presence of spread of infection through the urinary tract, different ages of infection. So we can find old sequence of old infection in the form of fibrosis and parenchymal calcification, because the primary TB will be medullary. And at the same time, you can find some abscess here, some enhancement of the pyelitis here. So there is mix between the chronic findings and the acute findings, and the distortion of the calcium system because of presence of fibrosis and multiple sites of calcifications. TB can be early and will be exactly like acute pyelonephritis, cortical abscess-like collection, and can be, this is for global calcification in early TB, or it can be late, and here it can represent as multilocated cystic appearance with a distorted kidney, between brackets, you call it beige kidney. So this is an example of renal TB with kidney distortion and calcium dilatation and enhancement. Another example of renal TB. These are my references. Thank you very much for listening.